I just want to remind Mr. Marcos that it was he who called for snap elections. And once the people decided to participate, he better watch out if he threatens to frustrate their will again. I'm afraid he will have an angry people on his hands.
Mrs. Aquino, you keep making what sometimes sound like veiled threats and sometimes not so veiled. What do you mean, he'd better watch out?
Well, all along I have asked the people, you know, not to engage in any violence. And so far they have listened to me. And if you may recall, just after my husband was assassinated, I did go on radio in our country. And I asked the people, you know, to observe peaceful means and not to resort to violence, and they did obey me. But this time, they have a greater stake in this. It's not just Cory Aquino, but the future of our children and our children's children. So if they think that they have been cheated out of an election, I'm afraid they might not listen to me anymore if I still insist on going about this peacefully.
Well, let me put it to you this way. You are running for president of the Philippines. You are putting yourself forward as the leader of your nation. And now, if I understand what you're telling me correctly, you're saying if the election doesn't go the right way, you may not be able to control even your own followers. That doesn't speak very well for your ability to be able to run the country.
Well, Ted, the people who are with me now are so convinced that I will win. And if Marcos resorts to terrorism or to gross cheating, then the people who have supported me may finally think that the electoral process is just not advisable anymore.
Are you raising the specter, the possibility of something approaching even civil war?
No, no, not civil war, as long as I can manage it. In fact, I have said that if Mr. Marcos cheats me out of this election, then I will call for daily demonstrations. However, if these daily demonstrations will still not get us the desired results, then I am afraid that the people might not listen to me anymore.
Mr. President, I don't remember any election in recent Filipino history, in fact, even in not-so-recent Filipino history, where the loser did not claim that there were technical and other reasons of foul. So, perhaps you remember one, but I don't.
I think you're right. Filipinos are not known to be good losers. They're always our great losers, and they never concede. But in this particular matter, Ted, I am so certain of victory that these declarations of my opponent that there will be a civil war in this country indicate how desperate they are. I certainly am concerned about your attitude that you feel there would be cheating if I win, and there would be no cheating if she wins. No, I think it's the other way around.
I realize it is a hypothetical question, but in every election, someone has to win, someone has to lose, and I wonder if you would address the hypothetical question, though. If you lose, will you stand down?
I have never thought of it, but certainly if there is no question which nullifies the results of the election, as I said, I will perform my duty as president in accordance with law.
Your claims and the claims of your supporters that you are so highly decorated are fabricated claims.
I don't think that that is the story. It's a story about my guerrilla group. It's not about the medals. Even here, when a case of libel was filed, the publisher here did not question those medals. It's only you Americans who question it. I am not going to degrade myself by talking about those medals. If the American government wants them back, they can have them back. It's a good thing that we did not burn them. It's a good thing that we did not burn them at the end of the war when you refused to give us our back salaries and refused to recognize all of us, and we were not entitled to education benefits, we were not entitled to medical benefits. But I was one of those who stopped our people from turning communist, especially the veteran, because we did not fight for communism, we fought for freedom. Now I wonder whether we also fought for the Americans and the American flag, to which we had sworn when MacArthur inducted us into the USAFE. I have no regrets, however, about having fought in Bataan. I have no regrets about fighting for beside American soldiers. I have no regrets about fighting under American officers. And probably if our country were ever to be attacked again, I would do the same thing. But I would certainly raise some questions about the conduct of the American government in relation to the veterans of the last war. I am certainly very disappointed.
Mr. President, the question is not raised about the courage of Filipinos who fought against the Japanese during the Second World War. But the question, as you know, and you know this is not something I'm making up, you have seen those newspaper articles yourself and you have seen some of the documents, suggests that the guerrilla group that you claim to have led, in fact, either did not exist at all or was just a tiny group that played no major role.
Then why is it recognized by the intelligence officer of General MacArthur in a paper which is certified too by the head of the archives of the United States? Now look, I don't want to talk about this anymore. If you do, I'm going to walk out.
You've had some rather disparaging remarks to make about Mrs. Aquino, not the least of them being that in effect she has experience as a housewife but little else. Do you think she has gained in stature over the last few weeks, and do you think it is possible that if she is elected, that she could serve effectively as president of the Philippines?
I still believe that you need somebody who has been experienced to run our government in this time of crisis. I have nothing against her, but certainly when, say, your son is sick and he needs an operation or he needs the expertise of a good doctor, you don't pick just anybody who has honesty and sincerity in order to cure your son. In that situation where she has no experience whatsoever is something that we have to accept and admit realistically that she had the nerve to run without any experience whatsoever, as she admitted, and it's not me who has said that she is inexperienced, it is her who said, what do I know about running a government? And as an ordinary citizen, I would cry out immediately against anybody who says that given the presidency. But as president of the republic, I think it's my duty to call attention to this danger.
I know that you made a great deal, and it is an excellent rhetorical device, of saying, yes, you are inexperienced. You are inexperienced in corruption. You are inexperienced in crime. You are inexperienced in dictatorship. But let's be candid about it. You are also inexperienced in leadership. Now, there is a difference even between running a campaign as the widow of a martyred and beloved leader and running a country. A country that is, as you yourself have pointed out, in a great deal of trouble. To those who are neutral about you, what do you say about your lack of experience?
Well, more than experience, I think it is credibility that counts. And the truth of the matter is that the Marcos government has lost all credibility, and no way can Mr. Marcos possibly lead our country back to recovery, because the Filipino people no longer believe in him. I realize that I am inexperienced, but as Mr. Marcos himself confessed, it took him 6 months to learn how to be president. And I guess I can do the same thing. As we all know, there is no school for presidents, so I don't think that should be a point against me. Your own George Washington definitely had no experience either.
It is possible that he had no experience as a president, but he certainly had some experience in leadership when he became president. And you are trying to become now the leader of a fractured country, the leader of a country that has enormous economic problems, the leader of a country that is rife with corruption, as you yourself have said, the leader of a country that has so many problems that one wonders how even the most experienced leader would be able to take care of them. I don't mean to harp on it, but it is the central issue of the campaign against you. And what I would like you to focus on for a moment is not you simply as an alternative to President Marcos, but you on your own merits.
I realize how many people may think that I am not, you know, the perfect solution to everything, but let's just say I am the best available solution to our problem.
There are a great many people within your own coalition, within your own party right now, who see you as a useful device for getting rid of President Marcos, but who may have plans of their own for then shuttling you aside and having used you, then taking over power themselves. How would you prevent that from happening?
Nobody can use me, and I showed this very clearly when I insisted that I would be the presidential candidate. I mean, if people wanted me to defeat Marcos, they would have to do it my way. And you can ask the politicians, the leading politicians in the opposition, how I was able to get all of them to agree that I would be the presidential candidate and not anybody else. Otherwise, we would have had two candidates instead of just one.
Again, Mrs. Aquino, the point I'm making is that I can see why they would be willing to stand aside for the immediate goal of getting President Marcos out of the way. But now we're talking about real power. Now we're talking about the power of governing and leading the Republic of the Philippines. And my question is, are you confident that you can continue to rule even when some of these people are going to be trying to take power away from you?
Yes, I'm very confident of that because there were no deals involved when I ran for president. So nobody has a hold on me. I am my own person. I intend to continue being that kind of person. As I said, I don't owe anybody any favors.
Let's talk for a moment about the kind of relationship that a government of the Philippines under Corina Aquino would have with the United States. What kind of a relationship would you want to have with the United States?
Well, I would like to continue our friendly relations with the United States, and I see no reason why that cannot be so. In fact, I would like to strengthen those relations, and definitely, we will be in direct dialogue with your government. So I really see no problems there.
Well, the problems again, and it seems to me that there has been a little bit of waffling on the issue of the bases over the course of the last couple of months. Would you tell me now, in these final hours of the campaign, precisely what your position on the bases at Subic Bay and Clark Air Force Base? What is your position now?
All right. I respect the military bases agreement, which will expire until 1991. And in the meantime, I will keep all of my options open. I know that no sovereign state can ever allow any part of its territory to be in the perpetual possession of a foreign power. And I think no ally of ours will be demanding this of me.
I am not hearing from you the kind of reassurance that I think Washington really wants to hear. Now, obviously, you're under no compulsion to give it, but I wonder whether that is deliberate.
No, it's not deliberate. Before the RP-US basis agreement expires in 1991, we will be in consultation with the United States, with our neighboring countries, especially the members of ASEAN. And above all, we will be consulting with the Filipino people so that we will be able to reach an agreement which will be to the best interest of the world, but in particular, the Philippines.
I've always maintained that those bases are needed by the two governments and probably by Asia itself. if not the world. You cannot project your naval and air power beyond the South China Sea as well as to the Indian Ocean and the Hormuz Straits in the Middle East without those bases. And we also recognize that Asian countries may be in danger if the balance of military power were not maintained between the two superpowers. And therefore, the ultimate and noble purpose of all of this is to maintain that military balance in order that we can avoid war in Asia. This is to the advantage of not only the United States and the Philippines, but to the advantage of all of Asia and perhaps of the Middle East, Europe, and perhaps the world.
When you hear people speculating in this country, and there has been some considerable speculation, that perhaps things are becoming a little bit too dicey in the Philippines and that the United States ought to think about putting its bases elsewhere. you take that seriously?
I take it seriously, and certainly we would not stop you if you want to get out of the Philippines.
You think that Subic and Clark can be replaced?
You will not be able to find any replacement of Subic and Clark, but you are free to get out any time you think it wise to do so.
Mr. President, some would say that the gravest danger to the Philippines these days is that there is a crisis of confidence, and that what Mrs. Aquino would bring to the presidency would be a fresh breeze, and that she could get the expertise by surrounding herself with competent experts, but that what is needed is a fresh sense of trust, a sense that the corruption that is charged will be cleaned out, a sense that the cronyism that is charged will be cleaned out, a sense that the brutality that is charged against members of your armed forces and the police will be cleaned out, and that Mrs. Aquino can fulfill that role and you cannot.
You, sir, are guilty of speculation and making allegations that are not proved by evidence. Corruption and hidden wealth were charges included in the impeachment proceeding. They were debated upon, and the opposition was challenged to present their evidence. They could not. There is no evidence. Even in your hearings in the House of Representatives subcommittee of Mr. Sola, Congressman Solomon and Roth, I think, have said that there is no evidence about corruption or hidden wealth, and that this is all hearsay and all rumor. Now you repeat it as if it is the gospel truth. I question your right to make this as a premise for any further questioning. I must say that hearsay, rumors, speculation as a basis for a question by reputable newspapers and foreign correspondents should have no place in a society like ours. Your society,
Mr.
and
President, you are quite right. If I were the only one raising those questions, there would be no point
the
in raising them at all.
The number does not matter, Ted. Whether 1,000 people raise it, if there is no evidence, then it is false. Whether it is raised by 10,000 people, if there is no evidence, then it is patently false. Numbers do not matter. It is evidence that matters. And you don't have any evidence. Mr. Solas has no evidence. The opposition has no evidence. They're just talking loud, and they're engaged in a smear campaign, and you're helping them.
Mr. Solars claims that he has testimony from someone who met with Mrs. who claims that he has testimony from someone who met with your wife, Mrs. Marcos, who spoke to him of properties that you hold through other names in New York, and that Mrs. Marcos said to this man who testified before the committee that she expected by 1987 to have $70 million worth in profits on those properties. Now, that is the testimony. You're saying there is no testimony. It may be inaccurate, but the testimony, sir, is there.
The witness, when asked by Congressman Solomon whether there is any evidence whatsoever proving this, said, I merely heard it. It is something that I heard from somebody. I do not know your sources of information. You may be more accurate than I am. But certainly, I don't consider that evidence which ties us up to the ownership of any of these properties. We are looking into the manner in which the evidence has been obtained by some of your investigators and some of your foreign correspondents, your newspaper men. And then after the elections, we will then look into the legal aspects of the coercion and intimidation that has been going on against some of the witnesses. But anyway, whatever it is, I deny categorically any speculations of the corruption and hidden wealth that is being alleged, so much so that the opposition members of the Batasan, the legislature, are now facing perjury cases in our courts, and we are going to see to it that these cases will be pushed through.
There have been charges by both sides against both sides of corruption in the voting process. How is it going to be possible for anyone ever to be satisfied that this was an honest election, even if it were?
Well, I guess as long as it is fairly honest, then we would be able to satisfy everybody. But if there are outright violations and we can see that there has been such enormous fraud, then that would be difficult to convince the Filipino people. But as I said earlier, since there are so many people personally involved in these elections, then we will see people power working to make sure that we get as clean and honest elections as possible.
How much fraud, how much corruption in the process are you prepared to accept?
Well, that all depends, Ted. Naturally, I cannot envision what Mr. Marcos is going to do. So I cannot say right now just what it is that I will be able to accept or what I will totally reject.
There is an enormous difficulty in ever reaching a decision on how much fraud there has been. Both sides are going to claim it. We know that already. Your side is going to claim it. His side is going to claim it. How is it ever going to be possible to reach an understanding on what happened and how much fraud there was?
Well, Ted, we all know who is the real power in this country, and it's a one-man power. So since he controls almost everything in this country, it is really unthinkable that we in the opposition, you know, can manage cheating the way he is accusing us of. He controls COMELEC. And he has all of the government forces behind him. So how can he possibly accuse us of committing fraud?
Well, if he has all the power, as you say, and if you already believe that he is committed to win this election by whatever means he can, then how is it possible that you're going to win?
Well, as I've been saying all along, it's people power that has finally emerged in this past campaign. And there will be many of these people who will be poll watchers in the coming elections. So they will be guarding their respective polling precincts. And they will also be watching the tabulations. So I am counting on all of these people to help us get an accurate count.
What happened during the campaign with regard to media coverage? President Marcos has told me that you have certainly had access to the television and radio stations, and he denies categorically that you have been kept off.
Well, you know, take for example the question of rallies and ours last night. I don't know if you were given a minute or two. But normally, all of President Marcos's speeches are covered in full. So I'll be lucky if I can have a sentence or two. We both addressed the Chamber of Industries, and his speech was covered in full. I think I had two sentences which I was allowed to, well, which local television aired. Maybe I can refer back to my husband's own funeral, where the Filipino people saw nothing of my husband's funeral, but which was viewed throughout the world. So things haven't changed much since that time. And I'm really lucky if I can get my face on television. What they are doing to me now is that they use some of my video shots and they impose it on their commercials. And then they have somebody pretending to be me and, you know, talking as if it were Cory Aquino. And there's nothing I can do about it because all of media is, well, all of television is under the control of Mr. Marcos.